IBC does not need to be changed. It's only an IBA recommended process, which several of the transactions and processes are looking at ways of circumventing to get. Yeah.
My only concern is that if somebody puts in a process, it will be taken as a prescription.
Yes.
And followed to the T. Which is what should not happen, because the flexibility is actually creating more and more biofriction.
But which is what is happening at the moment, unfortunately.
All right, so value maximization, and I have been saying this from day one, that it's an M&A process which is being run by the lenders, and no M&A process gets the best price without a competitive bid process, and especially when we have a problem of plenty when it comes to the buyers right now. So that's a good problem to have, but that has also led to various legal issues, Abizer. Is that frustrating the system as well? Are we finding loopholes of frustrating the system, and are these delay tactics?
Yes, of course. I mean, I think IBC has been delayed because of the legal system to some extent. That's fair. So a couple of things here. One is, we are Indians. If we lose, we love to litigate. We have to. So that's one thing that's ingrained in us. Secondly is, I think IBC or the judges the world over are actually less liberal while giving stays in legal cases. I think there should be a clear commercial stand taken and said, this is it. We're not going to do anything more than this. Mm-hmm. We have litigations around price. We have litigations around why was I not selected. The litigations around the process followed by the banks. I mean, we don't really need litigation around that. So, for example, particularly, what is the way a bank assesses a particular bid or COC assesses a particular bid is very internal to the COC. Why should any bidder know about it?
So, there's a lawyer. Are these also all unwarranted, or do you think that? Because we have come to some discovery in terms of valuation also because of certain aggrieved parties going to the court and changing the rule of the game as well.
We need to keep in mind, right, that the IPC has been such a fundamental shift in thinking, approach, perception, consequences for so many stakeholders in the industry. Mm. It's going to have litigation. I don't think litigation by itself is wrong. I don't think it destabilizes the law. I think the outcomes may or may not. I think litigation can actually strengthen a law. Mm. I think for a lot of investors, once there's litigation and it's been settled, they like that. Mm. They like the fact that there's a good law, but they like it even more if a good law has then been settled by the Supreme Court. So I think litigation is good. I think what I would like to see is a lot of these key issues go to Supreme Court, get settled once and for all. Mm. So we have now precedents backing the law. Some of these issues should not have been brought up. Some, I think, should have been. Mm. I'm hoping that the end of 6 or 9 months, we'll have a lot more stable law with a lot more stable precedents. And I think that's what we're looking for, really. I cannot expect, no one should expect, that a law as fundamental as this will not have litigation.
Sure.
Some of it being frivolous even.
Some of them may be frivolous, but some of them have really changed the rules of the game in terms of price discovery, I would say, as well. But, Abizer, another important thing which has really, we are still waiting for the ordinance to be cleared by the government, but 29A relaxation that has been proposed and could be really coming in. How will that really change the landscape? Is there a step down as well, and is that going to be beneficial?
So, 29A, the proposal, as I have seen in the proposal submitted to the government. Yeah. I haven't seen the ordinance. But whatever has been submitted to the government actually speaks about relaxing the criteria for 29A for MSME companies. Now, MSME, if you go down to the definition of MSME as per law, it's companies over turnover 25 lakhs. Hmm. So, frankly, it doesn't move the needle as far as IBC is concerned.
No, but as far as ARCs and stressed asset funds coming in...
Those are good. Those are good things. They've excluded these financial institutions because they always deal with stress. There's no point kind of saying that they're also responsible for... then they should not be bidding. So that's the good part. But I don't think that's been a deterrent. A deterrent has always been what happens to an existing small business where a promoter is involved. And you may not find too many other bidders except for the promoter himself. And there is merit in restructuring with the promoter. So it's really going back to what the law is overseas. But it says that, you know, if a business person or management believes that they are going through stress, they can come to the courts, they can ask for a restructuring scheme, the court approves the scheme and move on. Same management, same everything.
So we'll have
this
to
is what is required under 29A. So I think the answer would be that the threshold that is there, for IBC, the threshold would be around 200 to 300 crores of debt, and that will be useful.
All right, that will be useful, but in SR Steel case, where there have been many complications, we still have to see the earlier new metal bid and where it stands in that particular context. But what has really come in just recently is the Allahabad High Court stay on RBI's Feb 12th circular, only for power NPAs. So how do you read into that? Because Feb 12th circular was really creating the next lot of the IBC-related deals.
Well, I think we'll have to wait and see how it plays out and see how the RBI reacts to that as well. I'm not entirely sure that staying that circular is in the benefit of all these companies. Remember, what the RBI is not saying is, it's not saying push them into IBC, it's saying restructure. You've been sitting around with this for a long, long time, restructure. If the need is for more time, I think the request should have been for more time. I don't think the circular itself is at fault.
All right, so it's still interim in nature and still high court level, so there could be more proceedings on that. But it has had created a havoc with the entire banking system in the last quarter with the huge provisioning hit that was being taken. Abizer, very quickly, how has this impacted? Was this really required?
The 12th Feb 12 circular, I think it was extremely required. So I have no problem that Feb 12 circular. I think it did away with any of the antics that people were playing to avoid IBC. So there was this extension of SDR, 18-month moratorium. People who actually called it a moratorium on any loan repayments, which is not the case really. It's just a moratorium for the banks not to take provisions. But any which way, people have used it differently. I think what the RBI has now said is all schemes are out. Any prescriptive scheme is out. Now you come, I'm giving you 180 days, go and restructure a loan.
But it could be the end of the era for extend and pretend at least.
Absolutely.
When it comes to the banking system.
That era has ended. That era has ended.
That era has ended. So let's rejoice that. But thank you, gentlemen, for your candid chat on the entire IBC process. And it's an ever-changing world, so we'll keep coming back to you for that. Hope you enjoyed and got a lot of insight into where we've reached in IBC process. Lots more to be seen. At least NCLAT cases are shut at least for a month. So we have some sort of arresting period for some time, but then IBC processes are going to really take a lot of our time. Thanks so much for tuning in to Big Deal.